Hello, we're going to talk about something which is really small and forgettable in paper two. In fact, I imagine some of you may be looking at this video thinking, I've not come across this before. This is regarding inputs, processes, and outputs. So this all relates to how we can view a problem and how we can view a solution. It's one way of breaking down a problem into its component parts. So you can argue all computer programs are built up of inputs, processes, and outputs. And the whole point is we have some data being provided to us from the outside world. This data is sent to the processors, and the processors are bits of code which either modify the inputs or they perform some checks on the inputs. So they use the inputs in some way, and then based on what it's doing, it will then output some data back to the user in most cases. Okay, so how does this relate to software engineering or even just exam questions? Well, if you're given a problem, your first job might be to try and decompose it into its component parts, and you might use the input process output model as a template. So your first job might be, oh, what are the inputs, what are the processes, and what output do I want? But if the problem is finding the mean average from an array, I used this example in a couple of videos ago, what are the inputs to this? Well, I'm asking for an array this time. An array is a list of values. The input is going to be the array. So maybe the user types in the array, maybe it's written into a file or something like that, but I've got an array. What is the process now? What are the key steps required to get the mean average? This is me showing algorithmic thinking to try and think of an algorithm for this. Well, first of all, I need to add up all of the items in the array. Then I need to divide this total by the length of our array. That's how we get our mean average. And hopefully you can picture the sort of code needed to be able to do this. And finally, the output is quite simple. I will get a resulting value from the process. I just print it out to the user. If I was to substitute some values into this setup, well, I might have an array like this. My program would add up the numbers in this array, which happens to be 50 here. I'd find the length of this array, which is 5. I would divide 50 by 5, which gives me 10. And this 10 would get given to the output, which is shown to the user, maybe via a print line. Maybe it gets saved to a text file. It depends on what you're doing exactly, but the output would be 10 in this case. To show you an example of the code for this, here is a subprogram which performs the mean average from an array. So it's a function. And I'm showing you this partly just so you can see some actual program code for how to do this. I've got a for loop which adds the total. I'm using indexing to get each item. I'm then using .length to find out how many items are in my array. And I'm doing the division before returning it. I'm showing you this code because it's important you can see code like this, but also just to hopefully emphasize that inputs and outputs aren't always user inputs and prints. Here, I've not got a single user input or a single print. However, this is demonstrating input, process, output, because in a subprogram, any parameter I have is an input. I might also have user input, but if I've got a parameter, that's an input to the subprogram. The process bits of code are really the middle bit of our subprogram, the lines of code which actually are performing some calculations or checks on our input. So these are actually doing all of our processing work. And the output in a function, at least, would be a return value. So the return value outputs a value back to our main program. And if you're not super comfortable with subprograms yet, that's pretty normal. There'll be a video on this later in the playlist. Now, just to give you a final example of how this might manifest itself in paper two, well, they might give you a problem to analyze, and you might have to pick apart what are the inputs, what is the processing needing to be done, and what are the outputs involved in this. So here is a scenario. A sign up to a website needs a username and password. The password can't have been used already, and the password must be longer than 8 characters. The password must also contain a symbol. If these criteria are met, tell the user, sign up successful. Otherwise, say, try again. Now, hopefully you'd be able to code this or at least come up with some sort of algorithm. But as part of that, you'd have to pick apart what are the inputs, what are the processes, and what are the outputs. So this time around, we've got two inputs, really. We need both the username and the password, likely coming from the user. I've got a few processes to do, most involved just checking stuff. So first of all, I'm checking to see if the username is already in the database. Is there already a username with that value? I then will do a check to see if a password is 7 characters or less. I'll then check to see if it doesn't have a symbol. I've phrased these three checks kind of in a negative sense, because if any of these checks happens to be true, that's a bad sign. I need to set my message to be try again. I'm not outputting that message yet. That's the job of the output code. I'm just setting the message to be try again. Otherwise, if these are false, then we can set it to be sign up successful. And my output is quite simple. I can have multiple outputs, but typically we just have one. I'm outputting the message either try again or sign up successful.